Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Though people may be joining us from many regions, we acknowledge that the Church of St. Stephen in the Fields stands on occupied land, the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit and Anishinaabe people, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, and the Huron, Wendat, and Petuan nations, land covered by the Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant. Treaty 13 and the Williams Treaty are also relevant to this territory. We acknowledge that we have broken the treaties. We acknowledge the damage done by colonialism and the role that our church has played in this. And we pledge ourselves to work for a future of justice and reconciliation. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy, welcoming sinners and inviting us to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and keep you in eternal life. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace, everybody.
Peace.
Peace.
Peace, peace everyone.
Everyone.
Peace, everybody.
Peace, everyone.
Glory to God in the highest,
and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord, you alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we are taught by your word that all our doings without love are worth nothing. Send your Holy Spirit and pour into our hearts that most excellent gift of love, the true bond of peace and of all virtue. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
A reading from the first book of Kings. Then Solomon assembled the elders of Israel and all the heads of the tribes, the leaders of the ancestral houses of the Israelites, before King Solomon in Jerusalem, to bring up the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord out of the city of David, which is Zion. Then the priests brought the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord to its place in the inner sanctuary of the house, in the most holy place, underneath the wings of the cherubim. And when the priests came out of the holy place, a cloud filled the house of the Lord, so that the priests could not stand to minister before because of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel, and spread out his hands to heaven. He said, O Lord God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven above or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and steadfast love for your servants who walk before you with all their heart. A covenant that you kept for your servant, my father David, as you declared to him. You promised with your mouth and have this day fulfilled with your hand. Therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant, my father David, that which you promised him, saying, there shall never fail you a successor before me to sit on the throne of Israel, if only your children look to their way, to walk before me as you have walked before me. Therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you promised to your servant, my father David. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Even heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you, much less this house that I have built. Have regard to your servant's prayer and his plea, O Lord my God, heeding the cry and the prayer that your servant prays to you today, that your eyes may be open night and day towards this house, the place of which you said, my name shall be there, that you may heed the prayer that your servant prays towards this place. Hear the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray towards this place. O, hear in heaven your dwelling place, heed and forgive. Likewise, when a foreigner who is not of your people Israel comes from a distant land because of your name, for they shall hear of your great name, your mighty hand, and your outstretched arm. When a foreigner comes and prays towards this house, then hear in heaven your dwelling place, and do according to all that the foreigner calls to you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and so that they may know that your name may be invoked on this house that I have built. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts. My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God.
The Lord has found her own house. And the swallow knows where she left her young. By the side of your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God.
Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will be always be praising you.
Happy are the people who strengthen in you, whose hearts are set on the pilgrim's way.
Those who go through the desolate valley will find it a place of springs. For the early rains have covered it with pools of water.
From high to high, falls will reveal himself in sorrow.
Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Hearken, O God of Jacob.
Look upon the face of your anointed.
For one day in your courts is better than a thousand in my own room. And to stand at the threshold of the house of my God, than to dwell in the tents of the wicked.
The Lord is both stone and shield. He will bring praise and glory.
No good thing will the Lord withhold from those who walk with integrity.
A reading from the letter to the Ephesians. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I have Sarah doing the Alleluia in sentence. Are you ready to do that, Sarah?
Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia.
To whom shall we go, Lord? You have the word of eternal life. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
Jesus said, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever." He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. Then many of his disciples heard it. They said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you, there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that would betray him. And he said, "For this reason, I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Because of a series of feasts, our patronal Transfiguration, and Saint Mary the Virgin, we've actually missed just about all of the lengthy discourse which follows the feeding of the multitude in John's Gospel. Although at some unspecified point, the scene shifts from the deserted place of the feeding to the synagogue in Capernaum. It is a complex, dense, and sometimes provocative speech, in which Jesus identifies himself as the bread of life and speaks of the need for his followers to eat his body and drink his blood, using language and imagery which would have been profoundly shocking to his Jewish audience and frankly confusing for anyone. Something we lose sight of, perhaps, now that the words and images have become a common part of the Christian vocabulary. One of the accusations made against the earliest Christians was that they were, in fact, cannibals. And the raw physicality of this passage, of our central sacraments, is a thing we shouldn't forget. Because we are bodies. We don't just have bodies, we are bodies. We are not selves without this flesh, these muscles and bones and enzymes and neurons, these desires and pains, delight and sickness, all the things that are part of the body's life. And we believe, we say every week in the Creed, that God came to us, that God showed God's self to us in one of these human bodies. Jesus' ordinary body that touched other bodies, that worked at a trade, probably, a body that was tired and thirsty and hungry, a body that was broken, tortured and killed. Shall God dwell on earth? Yes, and in ways that Solomon could not anticipate. One of us and God's own. And because of this, we are all God's own. Bodies need food. It is easy living in a complicated political system to forget that the bottom line of politics is who will have food, who will have decent food, how we share or do not share. And we all want, understandably, to be the winners in this manufactured competition, to be the ones who eat, the ones who are safe, comfortable, fed. It isn't about physical hunger only, though that remains a cornerstone we mustn't forget. And Jesus only delivers his discourse about the bread of life after feeding the hungry crowd with real bread and real fish. But the unjust distribution of resources in the world is driven, in large part, by other and stranger hungers. There could be enough food for everyone to eat, but we find ourselves driven to accumulate, to compete, to want more than we have and others have, far more than we need, because we are hungry, we are lonely, we are frightened. We feed our hunger with the quick satisfaction of commerce and status and mistake this for what we want. But the bread of life discourse turns it all upside down as Jesus tells the disciples that he is the one who has come not to eat, but to be eaten, to be broken, given, consumed for the world's hunger. God gives us his flesh as Jesus goes without violence or resistance to be broken by power. As the flesh of this young man is handed over to power to do the worst it can possibly do. As this loving offering of a life is redeemed when the wounded body rises, when the risen Christ stands among the disciples and eats a piece of fish, shows them the scars of love, shows them that love can never finally die. And yet, in the midst of all the raw physicality of these images, Jesus also tells his listeners that the flesh is useless and only the spirit gives life. And we can't really blame the translation for this paradox, because it is the same Greek word, sarx, used both for that which we must consume to have life and that which is useless. The paradox, the meat and dirt of the world, which is both holy and inert, the distinction between mere being and the cosmos animated by the breath of life, the inability to see or draw that line clearly. It is in the midst of all this paradoxical stuff that we must search out our way. It is connected in a way to Paul's often misused metaphor of the armor of God, a metaphor in which Paul himself seems to lose interest partway through when we get to, for shoes put on whatever, but which is meant not to promote the kind of weaponized Christianity to which it is often hitched, but to communicate that our struggle is a profound conflict not with persons, but with systems, powers, principles of oppression, structures of inequity, which animate the unjust behavior of persons. And that to work against these, we have only the tools of faith, only the stubborn attachment to justice and truth. The world is very real, and its battle is very serious, and we must know the immediate moment, the physical particulars of our time and place. But we must also know the spirits and the structures underlying, controlling, creating, and we must live into counter structures, into a different spirit and life. Every bit of this is hard. It was even harder for the initial audience because Jesus weaves in a complex relationship with and critique of the story of the Exodus, the foundational liberation story of the Jewish faith, positioning himself, a small town carpenter's son of possibly dubious origins, as someone with the authority to redefine and renew that story. And finally, because Jesus in John's gospel rarely misses a chance to provoke people, he announces to the crowd that he is perfectly well aware that some of them are there as either random thrill seekers or with ill intent. It is perhaps not surprising, and indeed Jesus doesn't seem to be particularly surprised, that a large number of people who had been following him decide to abandon him at this point. It is clearly not quite true that only the 12 remained, but it may be that it was the 12 and the small accompanying group of faithful women who never seemed to be counted in the total. Not very many, at any rate. It's hard to know whether Jesus' words to Peter are an expression of sad resignation, or a request for an avowal of loyalty, or, and I think perhaps most likely, a warning, a last chance to leave before it becomes truly dangerous. And Peter's response seems to combine intense loyalty with a sort of helplessness. They are in too deep, they cannot walk away now, even if they're not sure exactly what's going on. It is not an unfamiliar feeling, I think. The realization that one has made a commitment, perhaps a commitment demanding an entire life, maybe without quite knowing it, and that this is now moving into something unexpected and demanding. I think we have probably all experienced some version of this in the last 18 months, as vocations and relationships have been tested under a stress that seems unlikely to end, even if this pandemic eventually eases. What does it mean in this time of the virus, this time of the early edge of climate disaster? This time when some are redefining how to live and some are trying to cling to how life has been. What does it mean to follow the one who has the words of life, who is the bread of life, when it is harder and less rewarding than it has been for a very long time? But all our devotions make demands, demands we never expected. We pledge ourselves to others and the world and walk towards cliffs of uncertainty, knowing that we, like Peter, will fail and falter, hoping that we will not betray, that we can hold on to the words, the stories, the movement of the spirit, the breath of life that is not owed to death. For where else can we ever go? Let us confess our faith as we say.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. for us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Eternal Creator, grant us the strength to persevere, coming together to be your hands and feet to one another and beyond. To the petition, Spirit of Hope, I invite you to respond, fill our hearts. We pray today in the worldwide Anglican cycle of prayer for the Anglican Church of South America. Specifically, your prayers are asked this morning in the Anglican Church of Canada for the Right Reverend Michael Hawkins, Bishop, the Right Reverend Adam Halkett, Suffragan Bishop, and the clergy and people of the Diocese of Saskatchewan. And in the Evangelical Lutheran Church in Canada, for the Dean, Council, and Congregations of the Southwest area of the Synod of Alberta and the Territories. Spirit of Hope,
fill our hearts.
In our diocesan cycle, we pray this morning for Bishop Priscilla Shaw, for St. Monica, its food bank, and its neighborhood advocacy, for St. Nicholas Birchcliffe, its weekly community lunch, its men's cooking and support group, and its participation in a community Christmas dinner program, and the churches by the Bluff Food Bank, and for St. Ninian Scarborough and its food bank. Spirit of Hope,
fill our hearts.
In our parish family, we pray for Elizabeth Cummings and Tucker Knight, Compton Downs, Joy Duran, Olivia Diswick, Anna Eisner, Sue Ann Elite, Maria Erskine and Hugh Thomas, Monica Fafiesi, Andre Forge, Keith Freeman, Hugh Goldring and Nicole Burton and Felix, Tucker Gordon, Peter Hairsnape, and Ken Peters, and Margaret Harry. Spirit of Hope,
fill our hearts.
Remember in your prayers those who are sick or in special need, especially Phyllis, Vanessa, Becky, Mark, Alex, Tasia, Damien, Tanis, Beck, Lavinia, Michael, Victor, Mary, Kadeem, Kim, Marvin, Ed, Roy, Andrew, Leonie, Dave, Margaret, and Gary, Sue Ann, Terry, Danette, Jean, Alicia, Georgina, Mother Joyce, and Deacon Allison, Yvonne, Verna, Andy, Ali, Christine, Maria, Cheryl, Emily, Venetia, Edith, Kira, Shelley, and family. George, Greta, and Laura. Remember the lost, the homeless, and all those who suffer through war and injustice. We continue to pray for those whose lives have been impacted by COVID-19, residential schools, the extreme heat, displacement, and war. Remember in your prayers those who have died and those who have lost their lives through acts of violence, especially this morning, Bruce King and Jack Bush. Rest eternal grant unto them, O Lord.
And may light perpetual shine upon them.
May they rest in peace and rise in glory.
Amen.
Eternal Creator, remind us of the goodness of your creation. Comfort your people and be with each of us in the coming days. Amen.
Alleluia, sing to Jesus, is the scepter, is the throne. Alleluia, is the triumph, is the victory alone. Hark the songs of peaceful Zion, thunder like a mighty flood. Jesus, out of every nation, hath redeemed us by his blood. Alleluia, not as orphans are we left in sorrow, no. Alleluia, he is near us, faith believes, nor questions how. Though the cloud from sight received him, when the 40 days were o'er, shall our hearts forget his promise? I am with you evermore. Alleluia, bread of heaven, thou on earth our food, our stay. Alleluia, hear the sinful plea to thee from day to day. Intercessor, friend of sinners, Christ Redeemer, plead for me. Where the songs of all the sinners sweep across the crystal sea. Alleluia, King Eternal, thee the Lord of Lords we own. Alleluia, born of Mary, earth thy footstool and thy throne. Thou within the veil hast entered, robed in flesh, our great high priest. Thou on earth both priest and victim in thy Eucharistic feast. Alleluia, sing to Jesus, is the scepter, is the throne. Alleluia. triumph is the victory alone. Hark the songs of peaceful Zion, thunder like a mighty flood. Jesus, out of every nation, hath redeemed us by his blood.
Let us pray. God of glory, receive all we offer this day as a symbol of our love, and increase in us that true and perfect gift. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of heaven and earth. We give you thanks and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. In our unending joy, we echo on earth the song of the angels in heaven, as we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Have made known to us in creation, in calling Israel to be your people, in your word spoken through the prophets, and above all in the word made flesh, Jesus your Son. For in these last days you sent him to be incarnate from the Virgin Mary, to be the Savior and Redeemer of the world. In him you have delivered us from evil and made us worthy to stand before you. In him you have brought us out of error into truth, out of sin into righteousness, out of death into life. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, a death he freely accepted, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, Father, according to his command,
we remember his death, we proclaim his resurrection, we await his coming in glory.
And we offer our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving to you, Lord of all, presenting to you from your creation this bread and this wine. We pray you, gracious God, to send your Holy Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the sacrament of the body of Christ and his blood of the new covenant. Unite us to your Son in his sacrifice, that we, made acceptable in him, may be sanctified by the Holy Spirit. In the fullness of time, reconcile all things in Christ and make them new. And bring us to that city of light where you dwell with all your children. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, the firstborn of all creation, the head of the church and the author of our salvation, by whom and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory are yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior taught us, let us pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
I am the bread of life, says the Lord. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry. Whoever believes in me will never thirst.
Taste and see that the Lord is good. Happy are they who trust in him.
The Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Grant us peace.
Let us pray. Living God, increase in us the healing power of your love. Guide and direct us that we may please you in all things, for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God,
whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of God, which passes understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and purposeful for thee. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from thee. Take my intellect and use every power as thou shalt choose. Take my will and make it thine. It shall be no longer mine. Take my heart, it is thine own. It shall be thy royal throne. Take my love, my Lord, I pour. At thy feet its treasure store. Take myself and I will be ever only all for thee.
Go forth in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And thank you very much, everyone. Adonica isn't here to thank everybody by name, but thank you everybody who contributed to the service. As far as announcements go, these are August type announcements. The Monday discussion group and the Tuesday Bible study are on hiatus. The Wednesday noon mass is continuing. And of course, the Friday drop-in and the Saturday and Sunday breakfasts. Also, for the information of everyone, God willing and the crick don't rise, I will be going to Prince Edward Island tomorrow, and I will be away until September 2nd. Janet will be holding down the fort in my absence, and Mother Andrea will be the priest on call in an emergency. She will also be doing 2 Wednesdays. And next Sunday, when if all goes to plan, I will be cycling from North Rustico to Montague in PEI. And I'm very grateful to everyone who has made this possible, including Tucker, who is heroically covering at the Saturday and Sunday breakfasts when both Anna and I are away at the same time. So thanks to everyone, and I'm very confident that everything will continue to run very smoothly in my absence, and be back on September 2nd and see you then. I don't think that there are any other significant announcements, but looking forwards a bit, the decision of corporation has been that we will, assuming that there is no change to provincial or diocesan regulations and that public health indicators seem adequate, we will start Sunday morning in-person services for at least a trial period beginning September 12th. Sunday, September 12th, assuming that there is not a significant downturn in the situation, we will have an in-person service in the church at 10:30 a.m. Masks will be required and distancing will be required, which means that our maximum congregational capacity will be 25. We are very hopeful that this will be possible and will continue, but as you know, with this pandemic, things can change, so anything can happen. When in-person Sunday morning services resume, the Sunday morning Zoom will end, but we will have a Saturday evening Zoom Eucharist for those people who do not feel comfortable at this point attending church in person. That will probably be at 7 p.m. on Saturdays. And, you know, we'll play it out going forward and see how it all goes. So watch this space, but assume that all being well, September 12th will be when we resume in-person worship in the church on Sunday mornings. I think that's everything I have to announce for now. I welcome everybody to stay for coffee hour after the postlude. And if you're watching us on Facebook, you should join us on Zoom and then you can stay for coffee hour. All you have to do is stay on Zoom, and after the postlude, we will move into an informal discussion period. So thanks again, and take it away.